Hi, everybody. Welcome back to GSX. My next guest, Dr. Jennifer Hesterman with Watermark Risk Management. Dr. Jenny, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me today.
Now, you're giving a lecture at GSX, the title, Insider Threat, Cross-Applying U.S. Government Strategies to the Private Sector. That's Wednesday, September 29th, 11:30 to 12:30, in the Defensive Strategy, Surviving the Unexpected Theater. This sounds like a really important topic. Tell us why this is something we should really be checking out.
It is really important. And the reason that I put in to do this session was because I teach graduate level security courses for Department of Defense. And last year, the Department of Defense wanted to create a 16-week insider threat course. And it's because they see it as their number one threat. Of course, you know, people in Department of Defense are in nuclear missile silos. They're flying aircraft that drop bombs. You know, they're air traffic controllers, things like that. So insider threat really is, you know, it has to work. It's a can't fail program. So with my experience 21 years in the military and then thinking about this course last year, I realized that when I talk to people in private sector about insider threat, they don't know where to start. You know, they don't know how to write a plan. They don't have training. They don't have a reporting program for their employees. So I thought I would just harness everything that I learned working insider threat issues with the military, which, you know, we're experts at this, really. We've been doing it for a long time. And people with security clearances that need continuous monitoring, things like that. I thought I would harness all of that and try to bring some lessons learned from the government sector and programs and unique ideas and tactics to the private sector. So that's what this session's all about.
Now, I might have been spoiled working at the studios for 10 years because our first consideration were inside threats, right? Because it's the people inside that want to share information with the outside about the movie stars, about the harassment cases, you know, all the gossip stuff, right? What is it about employers that make them a little reluctant or, I don't know, not good in this area? It seems to me that the first place you start looking is what's next to you to make sure that's secure.
Right. It's kind of the elephant in the room, right? Everybody wants to think that all your employees are loyal. But what we need to understand is our employees are really a cross-section of society, you know, so kind of look at what's happening in society right now. People are having financial problems. Maybe their mortgages are being called. A lot of people are teleworking, so we really don't have eyes on them right now where we could see behavior changes. We don't know what's happening in their lives. You know, and I always say people have a public life, a private life, and a secret life, you know, and that secret life is really where insider threat comes to bear because that's where they're melting down. And that's what could bring danger to your doorstep. So really during the pandemic, I think the issue of insider threat really came to the front burner because people were working from home. We weren't sure, you know, what was going on in their lives. So now that people are coming back to work, it's a good time really to institute this program. But yes, I think that employers are reluctant to talk about it because, you know, it's kind of like active shooter. They're afraid, you know, to even bring the topic up sometimes. So what I tell them is in the government, you know, it's on the front burner. We have training. We talk about it. And there's several ways that that employees can report, you know, in an organization if there's a program, you know, if there's a culture that supports their reporting. And there's key messages in Department of Defense. Like we tell people, you know, it's okay to admit that you have a problem. And that's the thing we want. We want people to come forward if they're having an issue, right? We don't want to have to rely on detection tactics to try to figure it out. So really just having that supportive culture and having the employee assistance program, which a lot of people already have, you know, connecting that to the insider threat program. But we want people to come forward. And in the military, I worked in the nuclear world for a while, and I was the personnel reliability program manager, which is PRP, and everybody was certified that worked in and around and with nuclear weapons. So if somebody had a problem, we would decertify them temporarily. So we'd remove them from their sensitive job until the issue was resolved, and then it had no impact to their career. You know, they'd still come to work. They just wouldn't work on that one sensitive area. So these are some ideas that I'd like to bring to the private sector and the for-profit sector that the government has had for a long time in terms of insider threat program. But yes, to circle back to your question, employers just skirt away from it. You know, they really don't want to talk about it with their people. And again, we want to believe everybody's loyal, but we need to understand that they're human, right?
Well said. It's so important. And of course, COVID stood everything on its head. All the models are different nowadays. Let's talk about the law. Has COVID changed the way we look at insider threats? Have laws been modified to allow employers to do different sort of background checks? You know, if I'm working at home, that's now the office, right? That puts a whole different layer on this. What can I check on that employee when they're at home I can't walk in their house and search their desk, right? All it's really different, isn't it?
It is different. And, you know, it's interesting that you bring up the law, because I think a lot of employers think that there's laws around the subject where they can't have an insider threat program. But the COVID really did change everything. And we had a lot of people on social media, for instance, that were, you know, under their real names, talking about their feelings about political issues last year, about the pandemic, things like that. So I think one area that we trip over is, can I look at my employees' social media? Because a lot of people are out there talking about their feelings under their real name. And so what I tell them is, you know, we don't want to spy on our employees, obviously, but other people are looking, other people are spying on your employees. For instance, in the business intelligence collection world, you know, or even worse, like the ISIS and Al-Qaeda world, they're looking for people who are melting down so that they can tap into their knowledge, possibly even get a backdoor into a company. So yes, other people are reading what your employee is saying online. And so possibly you should as well, you know, and there's no laws against that. But what's really interesting, Chuck, is when I talk to companies, I find out they're really good with onboarding. They're good with hiring, right? They screen their employees, they bring them in. And then in the onboarding process, they start to get a little bit lost in the company. I would say you should pair up a new employee with a seasoned employee, just like as a last minute eyes on check. But then once an employee gets into an organization, they just lose track of them. You know, there's no continuous monitoring. And what the military found was there was between 5 and 10 years delay between when your security clearance needed re-adjudication. So basically you'd have a top secret clearance, and at the 5-year point or so, they'd start to do a refresh and kind of look into it. Well, they found that a lot can happen, right? Between 5 and 10 years. So they started this continuous evaluation program where they're constantly looking at a person, you know, what is happening with their finances, what's happening in their life that could somehow bring danger to the doorstep, things like that. So I think for companies, they need to understand that employees are human. There's a lot happening in the world right now. There's a lot happening with our employees. And sometimes it's not even a willful negligence, right? It could just be somebody slips up and posts something sensitive on social media about a contract that the company's putting in for some R&D that they're working on. So insider threat doesn't mean that the person is willfully doing something against the company, but they could just be negligent, right? Not changing their password. We've had issues this year, like with the water treatment facility attack, where a former employee left under bad circumstances. They never changed the password. He logs in from home. He starts changing the chemical components of the water treatment system. So, you know, when an employee leaves under bad circumstances, make sure we're taking their badge back, that we're changing passwords, things like that. So really getting back to like the 101 stuff as well during this tumultuous times would really help companies.
Excellent stuff. Tell me why you're so passionate about GSX. What are you getting out of it this year? It's a whole different show, isn't it? Because of COVID and all this stuff.
It is. I'm really excited to get back in person. I do a lot of presentations and a lot of conferences throughout the year. And last year I shifted like everybody else did to online. I did what I could, but I love the contact with the audience. I like to talk to people before I present. I like to hear what's on their mind. I like to be around after I present because there are a lot of questions come up. You can't, you know, neat and tidily put it in the 60-minute box. So I really love the interpersonal contact. And then I just miss being on the floor, seeing the new technology, being able to touch it, see what's happening, and then just connecting with colleagues and peers. You know, it's been kind of lonely over the last year for a lot of us that like this kind of contact. So we're excited for GSX, and I'm so glad they're doing online as well to contact, you know, make contact with everybody who can't make it in person. But I will be there live in person. So when they play my session, I'll be there and I'll give it live as well. So I'm just excited. I'm excited to get back in person. I think they're taking the right steps and protocols to make sure we're all safe and healthy as well. I'm very careful with that, and I feel very confident about attending GSX this year.
It has been lonely, and I miss our in-person sessions, and I'm glad we're going to get back onto that. So make sure you check out Dr. Jennifer's session. It is Wednesday, September 29th, Insider Threat, Cross-Applying U.S. Government Strategies to the Private Sector. Fascinating stuff, and boy, something you can actually really use and benefit from. Dr. Jennifer, thanks so much for coming on GSX, and I'll see you at the show.
Yep, see you there. Thanks, Chuck.